This is a preview video for lecture 6. We're going to cover the skin, and this is also chapter 6 of your textbook. The learning objectives that we'll cover in this video, we'll focus on some of the earlier ones. We'll list the major functions of skin. We'll cover the structure of skin, including the tissues, the cells, and we'll build the skin. We'll talk a little bit about pigmentation and glands in the skin. What we'll cover in class will be some of these more specific topics, clinical topics. So list the major functions of skin. Sometimes we call it the integumentary system. Of course, it's for protection, a lot of sensation from the skin. As you know, temperature regulation involves sweating and blood flow regulation in the skin, whether you're hot and cold. And then some other things we'll talk about the skin. Vitamin D is essential for bones. It begins to be made in the skin. One of the things you might not think about your skin is what an important barrier it is. If you didn't have skin, you would dehydrate and lose ions, and this occurs in patients with severe burns that lose part of their skin or a significant part. They can actually dehydrate and die. Of course, you're continually exposed to stuff in your skin. Stuff can also get in your skin, so drug patches and things like that, and you lose a little bit of water through your skin, even besides sweating. So the structures of our skin: epidermis, dermis, and hypodermis. These are tissue layers. We layer them and stack them, and we build the skin structure. So if we were to draw and construct the skin, we would start like a three-dimensional block, which is our skin. Underneath the skin, deep to skin, is skeletal muscle. Usually skeletal muscle. And so then we start building the skin, and we start building the skin with connective tissue fibers like collagen fibers. The sublevel, or the lowest level of skin, has lots and lots of adipose tissue, so we draw that in there. And then above that layer is more and more densely packed collagen fibers and elastin fibers. Again, this is all connective tissue, the adipose tissue and the regular connective collagen connective tissue. We draw some elastin in there, elastin fibers, to make your skin not only strong but also elastic so that you can stretch it and it snaps back into shape. The collagen adds strength, and so this is the main bulk of your skin, is really connective tissue. And so then we'll continue drawing. We need to cover our skin. We need to cover the connective tissue, and that will be with an epithelial layer. So we draw that basement membrane, which holds epithelium to connective tissue, fill in a little more collagen, some adipocytes. And so that's the bulk of the skin. Now we need to draw in the final part, which is our epidermis, or epithelial layer. So we start with a base layer of stem cells, because we need to regrow that outer epithelial layer, and those stem cells are kind of cuboidal. And then we also need to throw in some pigment cells. We call those pigment cells melanocytes. We throw those in there at the base of our epithelium. And then we also stick in now some maturing and new cells, and as they mature they get flat, and then in the case of the skin we have a dead outer layer of epithelial cells. Okay, so the melanocytes are the pigment cells. We'll talk more about those. Most of the epidermal cells of your skin are keratinocytes. The outer ones are dead, and of course the ones growing are maturing, and those are alive. Stem cells give continual rise to them. Again, the basement membrane helps hold that epidermis or epithelium to the rest of the skin. So the epidermis is simply the name that we give to our epithelium of our skin. The connective tissue layer, with probably the most bulk and most size and most strength in your skin, is the dermis. Lots of collagen fibers, some elastin fibers. Again, those are just protein fibers. You even find some adipocytes sprinkled in the dermis as well. And then, of course, the cell that builds all that connective tissue of the dermis and lower levels are fibroblasts. Fibroblasts build the connective tissue. And so just again highlighting that collagen and elastin, those fibers give the dermis its strength. And then the sublayer of skin is called the subcutaneous layer. Sometimes it's called the hypodermis. It's really just basically fibroblasts made connective tissue with a lot of adipose cells, which we call adipocytes. And so we draw in the adipocytes, we call that adipose tissue. And some people don't consider the hypodermis part of the skin, but for our class in our textbook, we'll consider the epidermis, dermis, and hypodermis part of the skin. And again, deep to skin is skeletal muscle and some connective tissue, which helps protect the skeletal muscle. So that's skin structure. We could also draw in some hair follicles in our skin, and hair follicles are actually made by epithelial cells. The epidermis cells extend into the dermis, and those cells develop and make the hair molecule or hair follicle. and the hair shaft. We also have sweat glands. Sweat glands are actually epidermal derived as well. So the cells that make up your glands in your skin are also epidermal cells. And so we have sebaceous or oil glands. Those secrete oil onto the surface of your skin and the hair. Remember, the hair itself is dead. The hair that sticks out of your skin is dead, but the hair follicle that builds it to living cells. We also have eccrine sweat glands, which again are made from epithelial cells, epidermal cells, and those secrete watery fluid, which helps cool you off when it evaporates. We have some special sweat glands, usually in our axilla and our pubic region, called apocrine sweat glands, and they secrete a thicker sort of sweat that helps give you scent. So those are some things we find in skin. The other thing to remember, skin has a rich blood supply. Some of that is nutrition for your cells to bring oxygen and glucose, but a lot of skin blood flow is really just to help control your body temperature and heat regulation. So we can draw some arteries in there, some larger ones and smaller arteries that supply the dermis with blood flow. We can even draw some small little arteries and capillaries in there. We can draw some veins that drain the blood flow from your skin. We'll draw those a little darker since they usually have less oxygen. And so we have a rich blood supply that goes to the dermis. You notice that we don't have a blood supply in the epidermis because epithelium doesn't have a blood supply. It's avascular. So the nutrition that your epidermal cells get is from the dermis and subcutaneous layer. If you were to cut just your epidermis, you would not bleed. When you usually cut yourself, though, you cut through the epidermis into the dermis, and then you bleed out on the surface of your skin. So again, rich blood supply helps cool you off and helps bring nutrition. If you draw on your skin, you're really just drawing on that outer layer of dead cells. If you get a tattoo, you're actually having someone inject with a needle ink into the dermis, usually the higher levels, the upper levels, superficial levels of the dermis, and that's more permanent because you don't turn over the dermis as much as you turn over, say, the epidermis. So anything in the epidermis is temporary, anything in the dermis would be more permanent. Okay, so those are your layers of your skin. If we look at histology of the skin, you see the outer epidermis layer, the thick dermis layer, and then the underlying hypodermis. And so remember, most of that is connective tissue. Most of our skin is connective tissue. The top part of it is a little more loose connective tissue. The middle of the dermis is very dense, with packed with collagen and elastin. That's the thickest and strongest layer of the dermis. And then the other part that we have is our epidermis. Again, it covers us. We have layers of the epidermis. The base layer is called the stratum basale. The stratum basale is famous for having the stem cells and the melanocytes. The stratum spinosum is where we have our new keratinocytes. The new keratinocytes are just starting to mature. Most of the cells of our epidermis are keratinocytes. The stratum granulosum are where those little keratinocytes undergo programmed cell death or apoptosis. And then the stratum corneum is very thick in our skin, especially our palms and heels. That has the dead keratinocytes. That's the stratum corneum. So again, the epidermis renews constantly, whereas the dermis is a little more stable. It certainly turns over, but at a much slower rate. So we have much more stable collagen and elastin in that connective tissue dermis. So remember, those are just proteins that fibroblasts in your dermis build. The protein that you would find mostly in your epidermis is called keratin, which we'll talk about. Don't forget, the hypodermis is lots and lots of adipose tissue added to that connective tissue, and so we consider that more adipose tissue. Okay, let's zoom in on our epidermis and learn a little bit about those layers and what they do. So again, we see the epidermis on top of the dermis. Remember, the stratum basale has those stem cells and melanocytes that will give rise to your renewing and regenerating epidermis. We have our new keratinocytes. They're kind of rounded and cuboidal till they start to mature. We even can throw in some immune cells in our epidermis. And then we can also see ducts to our sweat glands there. So don't forget, the stratum corneum, the outer layer, is dead cells. The stratum granulosum are those dying cells undergoing apoptosis. And then, of course, if we keep going down, the stratum spinosum has the new and maturing cells. So this continuous movement of cells from the stratum basale up to the stratum corneum, and it takes weeks or days for that to occur. Melanocytes are located in the base, and they produce melanin, which are packages of pigment, and they hand the melanin off to the keratinocytes. And so that's why your tan is temporary. It's basically kind of goes out with your keratinocytes as they die. Don't forget the dermis has blood supply that adds nutrition and nutrients to all your cells of your skin. All right. I just wanted to point out that keratin is probably the most famous protein of your epidermis. It's really a intracellular cytoskeleton protein that is organized into filaments that you can see inside the keratinocytes or the epithelial cells. So keratin is really just basically a fibrous protein found inside of cells, which give them their shape and their strength. And of course, that's important for your epithelial cells in your skin, epidermis. And it's also the protein in hair. The major cell types, hopefully we already know those. Those would be keratinocytes, fibroblasts, adipocytes, melanocytes, stem cells, immune cells, and neurons. And hopefully you can recognize where these are located in our skin, in the different layers, either the epidermis and maybe the layers within the epidermis, or if they're located in your dermis. Neurons, I didn't really draw any neurons, but those are located throughout your skin, including around hair follicles, the epidermis and the dermis. We even have immune cells waiting for you to be attacked by something, and those wait in the various layers of your skin. All right, so those are the cell types that we've covered. Let's talk a little bit about your pigmentation or the color of your skin. What is that caused by and what's that due to? One aspect of your skin color is really just due to the blood supply in your dermis. So people can tend to have a little bit of a pinkish hue or a pale hue depending on the blood supply. And so that's variable, but the blood supply is red because of hemoglobin as a pigment. Most of the pigment, though, in your skin is due to melanocytes. Melanocytes are found in the epidermis and the stratum basale. And melanocytes are our pigment cells. They make packages of a pigment called melanin. And melanin is sort of like a protein lipid molecule. And those little melanocytes actually pass the pigment off to nearby keratinocytes. And then those keratinocytes carry the pigment until they eventually die and are shed off. So, and the melanin packages actually surround the nucleus, because that's their role, is to protect the nucleus of your cells. And we'll also talk about the fact that the melanin is packaged into things called vesicles, which you've already learned about. Vesicles are little shipping containers that cells can use. All right, so depending on whether you have dark hair or dark skin, or light skin and lighter hair, really just has to do with the amount of melanin you have. We all have probably about the same number of melanocytes. It's just how much melanin do those cells make. So again, the melanocytes package melanin into little vesicles. It can pass those vesicles between cells. And so the melanocytes have these little extensions which then can pass the vesicles of melanin to nearby keratinocytes, which then keep it until they're actually killed off and die. So what causes melanin production? Well, really it's damage from the sun, and also some of it are just base skin color is due to our genetics. But when do we get darker? Usually that's damage from the sun. UV radiation damages some keratinocytes. They tell the melanocytes that damage is occurring, and the melanocytes respond by making melanin. So the mechanisms of tanning really are simple. UV radiation from the sun damages your keratinocytes. The keratinocytes, when they get damaged, then respond by sending signals to nearby melanocytes. The melanocytes respond by making more melanin and passing that melanin off to nearby growing keratinocytes. So dermal damage can occur too, below the epidermis. You can sometimes get blisters, and if you start damaging the dermis, you damage the collagen and elastin. You start to get saggy, scarred, and wrinkled skin. And you can see that on the chest of some people who have been in the sun too much. The way you can protect yourself, of course, is sunscreen, which blocks the UV rays from actually reaching your epidermis and dermis. Okay, that's all I'm going to cover. The rest we'll cover in class. And I will see you guys in class.